This was a way that we are acknowledging a community partnership, and that's what we're doing here. So all of our law enforcement partners are accessible to you right now in a forum that is informal, and there's going to be an opportunity. I've passed out some agendas. I don't want to further delay. I'm going to pass the mic over to my boss and someone who's brought me here 9 months ago. I greatly appreciate that. My background was in gang work up in Suffolk County for about 13 years, and I'm very happy to be here. And thank you very much, Tim, for the opportunity to be here tonight.
Well, we're very happy to have Joe here. He's been really a great addition to what we're trying to do here in Brockton, and also the county of Plymouth. And I want to thank all of you for coming out here tonight to listen to where we're at and, you know, the direction that we're trying to go to try to make not just the city of Brockton, but the county of Plymouth safer for everybody. As you know, as Joe said, when we started Operation Safe Streets, I think it was June of 2015, violent crime here in Brockton was really incredibly unacceptable. And something needed to be done about it. Many years back, or 8 years or so back, we were involved with Project Safe Neighborhoods, which was a strategy in the early 2000s to deal with a lot of the gun and the violence that was occurring here in the city of Brockton. The funding for that program ended 8 years ago. And it was time to try to go back to that. Whether or not we had funds, it was important for us to try to make sure we could get back and sharing information as we could. Because 2015 was a particularly bad year for gun violence in the city of Brockton. To put that in context, I want to give you some statistics that we've been able to get and extrapolate with our federal partners who are involved in this also, ATF, FBI, as well as a lot of other resources that we have here. The city of Brockton has been great. But in 2015, between January and May, we averaged 5 days between shots fired incidents. Between May and the end of September, at a time when one of the worst winters had ever ended, and everyone just wanted to do really nothing else other than to go out and be outside with their families, we were averaging a shooting every day. Between October and the end of December alone, we had 7 shootings in which somebody was hit. And in 2015, Brockton had 5 murders committed with a firearm. On the whole, Brockton averaged 11.5 shot fired incidents per month in 2015. We attribute this to a variety of things, including rival gangs, robberies, drug distribution crews in this city engaging in reciprocal and retaliatory violence. So far in 2016, we're averaging 5 shots fired incidents per month, cutting the 2015 monthly average more than half. Between January and June of this year, there have only been 6 shooting incidents in which someone was hit by gunfire. And we have had, with the exception of a tragic murder-suicide in June, no other homicides in the city of Brockton in 2016. Now, this is not an accident, and this does not happen overnight. Cooperation and collaboration amongst law enforcement has been key to driving down firearm-related crime to one of the lowest levels that this city has ever seen. And a lot of those agencies are sitting here today. With the help of several long-term federal investigations by the joint FBI and the ATF task forces under the direction of the U.S. Attorney's Office, our homicide investigations led by our state police CPAC unit and assisted by the local departments that left absolutely no stone unturned. Solid everyday work by the state police gang unit, the CAT team, the road troopers, the Brockton police, the Brockton detectives, support from the Plymouth County Sheriff's Department, and some successful prosecutions by assistant DAs in my office, some of the most violent offenders in the county of Plymouth have been taken off the street for years, and some for life. Pooled resources, information sharing, and the absence of ego have made our law enforcement relationships in Plymouth County a model for the entire country. Our successes in 2016 are not attributable to the work of any one agency. Rather, our success is attributable to the willingness of all these agencies and more working together toward a common goal. In addition to our regular monthly Safe Street meeting since last summer, we've also made stemming street violence and the flow of opioids a primary focus for our office. In early 2016, notwithstanding the fact these are difficult budgetary times, and without any additional funds, we created the position for Joe Janizek, our gang community prosecutions unit, which is staffed with some incredibly seasoned prosecutors to focus on the most dangerous individuals affecting violence in this city. We've also created an opiate task force, which focuses stemming upon the tide of the opiate distribution in the county. And I have made community partnerships and outreach a number one priority to enhance our accountability to all the people who we are serving. And that is all of you, all the citizens here in the city of Brockton, and all the citizens here in the county of Plymouth. Now, I say this not because we're going to pat ourselves on the back. I say this as a challenge. My office and the law enforcement partners on the federal, state, and local levels are doing everything we can to stem the tide of violent crime in the city. But I and many of the police officers up here have been around long enough to know that this will not last unless everyone gets involved with this effort. And so far, we've had tremendous response from neighbors about crime all over the city, including the north side. In turn, we've linked our law enforcement partners directly with the residents, or if that's not possible, pass the information to them. If one drug house can ruin a neighborhood, one successful prosecution can easily change it for the better. And this is where you all come in. Since restarting the Safe Streets meetings last summer, we have received incredible feedback and tips from residents on drug distribution and gang activity in the city, as well as feedback on how effective our efforts are on the streets. And it's these relationships and feedback that will ensure our recent successes can be turned into long-term successes. Our message should be clear. Brockton is not a bedroom community for other communities, gangsters, or drug dealers, and they will not find a safe haven here. If you are a criminal who hurts people, either through violence or by distributing the poison of heroin and fentanyl, you will be on our radar, and we will do everything in our power to prevent you from hurting the neighborhoods of Brockton or the residents of Plymouth County now or in the future. But as I said, law enforcement efforts can only carry us so far. We can't view arrests and prosecutions as the only way to a safer city. We need to do more with social service providers, street workers, local clergy, schools, youth, and most importantly, the residents of each and every neighborhood here in the city of Brockton. We have accomplished a great deal toward this goal. And once school is back in session, we hope to build even more partnerships and dialogue in the coming months. Imagine the status quo in the city of Brockton as the past 8 months, as opposed to what came the years before. Know that my office and all of our law enforcement partners are working tirelessly every day toward maintaining the recent peace. And I'd like nothing more than to be back in front of you in 6 months or a year, reporting the same peace. Because if I am, make no mistake about why. It's because everybody in this room is playing their part in making this community safer. And on behalf of not just others, residents who may not be here tonight, or other members of the County of Plymouth who may not be here tonight, I thank you for all of your efforts and hope that we can continue to work together in a cooperative fashion with our local law enforcement agencies to make sure that we continue to rid our streets of the dangerous individuals who are out there. I am confident that we're going to be able to do that. And I want to thank you all for coming out tonight.
Typically, what we'll do at these meetings, and again, we are very happy to be here, and we'll come back. If you want us, we'll be back. What we'll do is typically we'll give some law enforcement updates if there are any folks in the room who would like to give any updates. That would be terrific. I have some from our office, but in terms of, again, the introductions, Lieutenant Kovnarath from our state police unit is here. Did you all want to have 2 minutes to just talk about it? I'm putting Lenny on the spot right now. Apologize for that. He's going to find me in the parking lot afterwards.
So. I gave all my stuff to the DA to read, and he did a great job at it. So, No, there's not much I can build upon with that. The cooperation between Brockton and our office goes back decades. We work with the FBI, our uniform division, any police agency within Plymouth County we're working with, and we've all come to Brockton and work together. And it's important that people reach out to the local department, state police department, the federal entities, the sheriff's department. If you know somebody that can help, reach out, make the call. That's what makes the difference in this situation. Everyone's doing a great job right now, and we hope to continue that work.
Good evening. As the DA said, a lot of hard work has been done by many agencies in the city of Brockton, and it's the cooperation that has led to the success that we're living in right now. Now what happens in my job is we turn our, now that we are not doing those other things, which are very time consuming, the homicides and things like that. Okay, we turn ourselves to other things, which are quality of life issues. And this is where you folks and residents can get involved. We have a C-Click Fix that you can go on the City of Brockton website and send us tips. We don't need to know who you are. We just had a very successful operation down the south end of the city where it came in anonymously to us. Within 2 weeks, we were able to rid that, that neighborhood of what was a very bad situation that was causing haunting for a lot of residents. And we got a lot of accolades from the neighbors down there. Nobody knows where that came from. It was safe. It was done appropriately. And now we'll wait for the prosecution. But in reality, they move out. And my theory on the city of Brockton is you have to care for your neighborhood. We'll take care of the rest of the city. I don't care if they move somewhere else. That's not your problem. We want to hear from you so that we can get them out of your neighborhood. And if they move somewhere else, hopefully that neighborhood calls and we'll just keep going after them, okay? So please, take advantage of the tip line, those anonymous things if you don't want to get involved. If you do, you can also talk to a detective. If you feel up to it, and they will keep you anonymous. But you can have a personal relationship too. So please keep the calls coming because it makes a difference in the neighborhoods.
Just say that the prosecution, I mean, like I said, they've done an incredible job. The federal authorities work in conjunction with the Brockton police. Chief Crowley's leadership has been really good since he's been the chief here. And I think that, you know, dealing and working with, you know, we have the FBI here tonight. They've done an incredible amount of work with the other agencies, like I said. And that information is valuable, and it gets some real bad guys off the street. And more importantly, it makes the other ones not want to stay here. Because the word is out right now, and I think that's a big piece of what's going on. A lot of the federal investigation, I don't know if Kevin wants to say something real quick. They've done a tremendous job.
Real quick, Kevin White, I'm a supervisor with the FBI in Lakeville. I just think it's important for you guys to know that we've been working great with the state police and Brockton PD, and we just had our first guilty plea in federal court. So these guys are graduating the federal court. That's a good thing. It's a good sign. And what the DA Cruz was saying, which was great to, I wish you could have seen it on the last sweep we did when we locked up the guys a few months back. He said to his friend, "I'll be out this afternoon. I got to run over to court in Brockton." On the way up there on the highway, he said, "Where are you going?" He said, "We're going to Boston. You're going to federal court." And I can tell you, that resonated. He started crying. This is a tough kid who's been involved in a lot of violence. He's crying in the back seat. He knows he's going away for some time. So that's the first guilty plea we've had in the federal system on this recent wiretap. And I want you to know that, I'm sorry?
Can't hear you, Kevin.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry about that. I just wanted to just reinforce that the federal statutes that we're applying to these guys, they're good hits, they're hard hits. And to DA Cruz's, congratulations to DA Cruz and the state police and Brockton PD, one of the more recent homicide trials. Just to let you know, the effort, there was a witness that we needed to locate, the state police and Brockton PD and the FBI, and we found him over in Cape Verde and brought him back to testify. Right, Tim? I mean, it was great. I just wanted to emphasize that collaboration. So we're gonna continue to use every asset, every tool we have, and continue to get these guys before they do any more violence here in Brockton. So thank you, DA Cruz. It's been very successful.
The joint effort between all these agencies up here has been nothing short of spectacular. I live in Brockton, and I can see the difference over the last 6-7 months, maybe to a year. Again, when you can federalize these cases, they get real time. It's a different system. They're going away. I mean, even if they get held for the trial, it's 2 or 3 years before they go to trial. And bail in the federal system is the exception, not the rule. So when they do get locked up, they're going to be held for their trial up to 2, possibly 3 years before they even go to trial. So as you can see, the collaboration between these agencies is starting to make a dent. But again, the citizens, we really need your help. You're the eyes and ears out there. If you see something in your neighborhood, call somebody. And everybody up there would be more than glad to help you.
So Kevin raised one of the highlights of our summer, a prosecution of a gentleman, and I use that term loosely, who committed a double homicide, a horrific act in the city. We don't make those cases without folks coming in every day, and people do come into court every single day, because that's the system that we have. And folks come in and they raise their right hand, and they tell what they saw. They tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help them God. That's the standard. And we cannot help hold people accountable without that type of participation. And sometimes perception becomes reality for folks, and word on the street is that you're snitching or something like that. There's this culture of no talking. That's perpetrated, I want to tell you, and our partners in law enforcement will tell you this, that is perpetrated by a very small group of individuals who are criminals. And I will tell you something else about those individuals. Those are the same guys who, when they get locked up on a case, are begging to talk about all of their friends. So there is no honor. There is no honor. But in terms of folks stepping up, there have been, I will tell you, hundreds of folks in the city of Brockton who have stepped up just this year, come into court, raised their right hand, and done that scary thing on behalf of everybody here, everybody in this room, everybody in the city. That's something to trumpet. That's the story that you don't hear, and that's something that we've made. These are guys that carry firearms, that shoot people, that are distributing drugs with impunity. As Kevin said, there are folks that kind of laugh at the system because they have either skated or gone under the radar. And so rather than us be up here and lecture you, this is about feedback, and this is about what you're observing and your questions. And thank you, ma'am, for your question. I'd like to invite more of that. I think what we're in is a period that is, frankly, I think it's unprecedented. I mean, a stretch for a major metropolitan area like Brockton to have gone without a violent homicide, save the one referenced by DA Cruz earlier this year, is really extraordinary. I'm a big student of, and I was, as I said, I mentioned, I was up in Boston for 13 years prosecuting gang crimes. I'm a student of the Boston Miracle, and that's, y'all may have heard that. That's been a model for the rest of the country in terms of a successful police and prosecution and community model. And I'll boil it down for you. I'm not going to bore you, but we had the highest rate of homicide ever in the city of Boston in the mid-90s when I was growing up. I was in college as it spiked. And folks, everybody, and I don't mean just law enforcement, because they were fighting the fight and we were fighting the fight that we always fight, but everybody said enough is enough. There's an unacceptable level of violence. It was punctuated by the killings of some youth, and that drove it home for people. And so everybody got together, they closed the door, they all got into a room and they said, we're checking our ego at the door. I'll boil it down for you, and I won't bore you anymore with the story. The lesson that came out of the Boston Miracle is what we're doing right here. Collaboration. It's not about one agency or one parish or one community group doing the work. It's about everybody doing the work. And I will tell you, this is the key to success right now is to keep the pedal down. So DA Cruz has been banging this drum, and I appreciate that, because that is what we are doing. We are keeping the pedal down. We're keeping the accelerator to the floor, because this piece is fragile. And so now we need everybody to come together and say, okay, look, here's what I'm noticing on my street. There's a drug house down the street. I know they're selling. I see people in and out of there all the time. Now, you can do two things with that. You can say, well, geez, there goes the neighborhood. and throw your hands up and close the blinds, or make a phone call. And you have all the partners here from law enforcement that you have that you need to ask questions of, and you may feel comfortable asking a question now, or you may feel comfortable asking a question after the meeting, or you may feel comfortable making a phone call in the privacy of your own home. That's fine. But the point is to make that phone call, to ask what do I do with that information, and that'll focus resources. Lieutenant LeGrice and our state police contingents, they can't be everywhere at once. They cannot be everywhere at once. You are the eyes and ears of your neighbor. But what I will tell you about, so these precursors, what to look for, and we made this as an agenda item. You know, drug activity, are there people coming and going at all hours of the night? Do they not stay for very long? Is there a steady stream of people in and out? That's something if somebody's, walking up to a house or walking up to a car in front of your house, that's the kind of stuff that you're looking for. What does that bring with it, though? Why is that a big deal? Well, because with drugs come violence. Because somebody says, hey, that guy's making more money than I am, so I'm gonna go and rob him. And drug dealers don't call the police when they get robbed. What do? They pick up a gun. They have their own gun to defend themselves. So this is the dynamic that we're talking about. And folks will go into quiet neighborhoods. They'll go where people aren't necessarily gonna notice or care. And that's a problem, that's problematic. I'd like to open it up to the floor and hear what your thoughts are.
Can I also just recognize the elected officials that are here too, and other officials? I see that we have Councilor Lally, Councilor Barnes, we have Steve Bernard, the president of the Brockton area and NAACP, and I think Jerry Cassidy's still here. Oh, there he is, I couldn't see you, Jerry. And I want to thank them for coming and also and being a partner with us. Yes, Shane.
I did have a question. Thank you all again for coming and making this a constant event for the residents to attend and get information, also to information share. I
just wanted to ask, I know that there was a program a few years ago that the clergy went out with some of the police officers for at-risk kids to kind of do like a prevention program. So I don't see any clergy here today, but I don't know, is there any push to incorporate some of the clergy? Because like you mentioned, it's about the collaboration. So that would also, be something that I would suggest to do if there's not a push for that already.
So I can speak for our office, and I can say, Councilor, yeah, absolutely. We've in fact had numerous discussions with the BIC, Brockton Interfaith. Council and we're intending on partnering more. That's integral. That's key. And in terms of Brockton Police, I'll let Lieutenant LeGrice talk about that. But I know there have been a lot of things that they've done. Well.
We do have ride alongs that the clergy go out with us and assist us in different things. And a mental health portion that is providing services throughout the city that includes pretty much all the faiths in the city of Brockton.
And can I also say that the one other thing that we have going on, which is not really dealing with the violent crime stuff, but we have a Plymouth County Drug Abuse Task Force with myself and Sheriff McDonald have organized it a year and 3 or 4 months back. And really what it is, it's dealing with the opioid crisis and the problems that are going on. And you talk about it's really that kind of, that holistic approach. If it's not just law enforcement, but we're dealing with hospitals, law enforcement, legislators, faith-based, we're dealing with Teen Challenge. We have people that come to our meetings and talking about how we can try to get in front of this problem that a lot of people have right now. It's a huge challenge, it's a huge issue. And in trying to get help for the people that we can help, but also understand also that when somebody does break into your home or steal your car, they've also committed a crime, and we have to deal with that also. So what we're trying to see, and what we're hopeful that we're gonna be able to do on that end of it, is in continuing to work with all those different agencies, is hopefully try to get more beds for people who are addicted to that terrible substance, because it is just killing people as never before. Back, 30 years ago when I was a young prosecutor, the street level purity of heroin here in the city of Brockton, back when I think Kenny was just a regular police officer back then, I was just a regular line ADA, was probably between 15 and 20% pure. The heroin that you see now is anywhere between 90-95% pure. It's incredibly cheap. And you have a lot of people who are starting out, whether they start out with marijuana, whether they start with prescription meds, you have a lot of people who are ending up with, unfortunately, they're mainlining heroin and they're dying, especially because they don't even know what they're getting anymore. Back in the day, it used to be like you'd get a baggie, it'd be a stamp of like, say, Red Dragon or Blue Angel, whatever it was. You knew the brand you were getting. But the dealers know that we're trying to follow those brands back. We're trying to find out where they're coming from. So that if we can trace that, which is incredibly difficult, trying to go back to the dealers and trying to get them off the streets, the people that are peddling that stuff, so they've removed their markings on it now. So unless you have somebody who's a user who perhaps overdoses and comes to life again through Narcan or whatever the issue may be, unless they're willing to give up their deal, which 99% or not, you're not going to be able to make that step. And I think that's frustrating sometimes when you're trying to get at the true dealers, not the people who are using, that may be selling a couple bags to keep their habits going. But I'm talking about the true dealers who do not use and who do not care that where you are or where you're living or what's going on. So that's another challenge. But I think in trying to bring in different groups and maybe the non-traditional partners that I think of law enforcement, I think that's a strategy on that end. And I think it can work on this end too.
There is work to be done. There will be a next thing. The question that we all need to have in our mind is, what do we do about that next thing? What will we all do about that? Will you call, as you said? Or we say, well, that's just Brockton, or that's just our neighborhood, that's just this block. And I think we're hearing a lot of people making that call and reporting that, and that's a great thing. We track those calls. Obviously, the Brockton Police are the recipient of those calls, and it matters. We use it to gauge how we're doing, how the city is doing. One of the things that I know from my prior work is if you're not hitting the precursor activity, the stuff that's the lead up. There's all those warning signs. So when a plane crashes, right, they say it's not just because of one thing. It's a lot of different things that go wrong. When someone gets shot or there's gang back and forth, which is retaliatory, so one shooting to two shootings equal four, four equal eight, all of a sudden it balloons up. And for every one of those shootings, that's a potential homicide. You have to view every one of those shootings as a potential homicide. And, you know, the homicide rate is one thing. What's the shooting rate? What's the, you know, is it just that people are bad shots? You know, or is crime really down? And what we can say at this point is that not only is the homicide rate down, but the shootings are down. And that's a great thing. But what are the precursor activities, okay? Kids, the number one thing that you see is kids congregating on a front porch or in a park area and setting up shop night after night after night, okay? That is a number one red flag for something to happen down the road, because another group of kids is gonna ride by and say, where are you from? And that's how it goes. You know how I know that? Because I've seen hundreds of shootings that have happened, and a lot of them start like that. So what do we do? What are we marching out of here with in our mind? Call. Hey, there's a group of kids in the park. It's after dark. The park is closed. You know, just want to let you know. And the Brockton Police are unbelievable at responding to stuff like that. That moves those kids along. That gets them out of that pattern. And all of a sudden, they're not a stationary target. And somebody can't ride along at some point and fire some shots at them, which, you know, is going to be a problem down the road, because, hey, I know who those kids were and I'm going into their neighborhood next because I'm going to get them back, because we can't let that go unaddressed. That's how it goes. So unfortunately, folks feel that there's a calm and so it's okay, but to keep this going, it requires that kind of constant vigilance, and I thank you for yours.
Thank you for coming this evening. My name is Steve, President of the NAACP in Brockton. Question about the numbers of police officers, cities, state, FBI, that cover the streets of Brockton, sundown to sunset. A recent article say that we don't, for a city of our size, we're understaffed for the number of local police. And the numbers of the police that are actually working at sundown to sunset are hopefully low relative to other cities and towns in the state of our size. Between the local police, the state police, and other agencies that are in this partnership, can you give us an idea of the coverage that we have, the police coverage we have? And during those hours, where are you patrolling? I don't know, don't give away your secrets, but where are you patrolling? And are you also patrolling what seem to be the quiet neighborhoods, where, of course, drugs could be sold, and people are not expecting that they would be sold in those areas, but police presence would resolve that problem also. Give us some numbers so that we'll know that we have the coverage that's necessary once the key is safe.
Well, if you're asking me if we can use more police officers in the city of Brockton, we can always use more police officers in the city of Brockton. As far as the numbers go, sir, I'm not going to get into how many members we deploy in each shift and what we have out there. What I can tell you is that we add to those numbers as crime increases and as crime may dictate. As far as the state police, their being in the city of Brockton is constant. But to be honest with you, when the CAT team's in here, they may be called for other duties, okay? But they spend a lot of time in the city of Brockton and do a great job. So between the Brockton police, the state police, FBI, the gang task force that we have in here, we have quite a few people working every single night in the city of Brockton. Okay, but could we use more men in blue uniforms out on the street? Absolutely. One of the things is crime moves by motor vehicle. Okay, the more people you have in blue out there, the more motor vehicle stops you have, the more chance you have of catching people. As far as I'm concerned, we can use more, but the city of Brockton is headed in the right direction right now, but I can tell you right now, we could not be in this position without the partnerships that we have.
This is, you know, also for my information, just so I'll know. The number of police, do you also have an increasing number of foot police or a decreasing number of foot police, motorcycle police, or bicycle police? Is that, what has been the trend over the last 5 years or so?
Well, I know that they've been putting out more motorcycle police officers. They do have foot patrols in certain areas of the city. I think those have, I believe they've been cut back for a little while to put more people on the streets with some of the things that have been happening across this country, and meaning that we need more rapid response. With regards to your comment or your question, sir, regarding the neighborhoods, I hope our patrol division is patrolling the entire city. But we are very reactionary, okay? We go where the calls come from, the calls for service come from. So if the downtown is condensed and per square mile, there are more people living down there, and there are more issues down there, yes, they're gonna see more police officers. But I do like to think that and I know that the officers are getting out to those other neighborhoods also. I will also say that those other neighborhoods are, for some reason, are much more apt to report suspicious activity in those neighborhoods because it's more prevalent. It's easier for them to see and to determine that hey, that doesn't belong in my neighborhood. So we do get those calls also. Like if 2 a.m. in the morning I see a man with a hoodie walking behind a business and he's got a bag and he's carrying tools, am I profiling that guy? How do I know what he's doing? Maybe he's a repairman, but you know what, my job is to go check him out and find out what he's doing. So I really, really have to understand that profiling can have a negative connotation, okay? And the way we use it, or that it's used in law enforcement now, it is negative. But to be honest with you, drug dealers are drug dealers. They have the same actions. They have the same mannerisms. They're meeting for short times in a parking lot. We watch those parking lots. We see that, okay? We may pull a car over, okay? It's not random, it's not But what we're looking for is the suspicious activity that gets us to that threshold that we can make a stop. Okay, and that's what we do.
Sir, in simpler terms on the streets, what we do is we profile, or we profile behavior. You understand? We profile behavior. That's what we profile. That's what we're looking for. Everything else doesn't matter. Time of day, crime rate in that certain neighborhood, what we're looking for is behavior. That's what we profile, regardless of anything else. That's what we try to teach our street cops, the ones out there wearing this. You see what I'm saying? That's what we profile, is behavior. Criminal behavior is what we try to profile.
And what I will say is this, and from a court perspective, from a legal perspective, we live in a state that is on the absolute cutting edge of individual rights. And I think what you will see is there is a distinction, and I know you used the term profile. None of what these officers do is called profiling in that sense of the word. And what we call it and what it is reasonable and articulable suspicion based upon objective facts, okay? That's what our standard is when we go in to a courtroom with these officers. When everybody Monday morning quarterbacks and says, "Well, why did you?" and they nitpick every single move, which is what our system is. We invite that. That is what our job is. Their actions on the street at 2 o'clock in the morning, when they approach a car that's filled with five people, is analyzed over the course of sometimes hours and days in a courtroom. And what these officers are bound to is a standard of reasonable and articulable suspicion, an objective, not subjective, observations. So what they will have to do is get on that stand and say, this is why we did it. And to Lieutenant LaGrice's point and to the trooper's point, these are actions, these are patterns, these are things that folks that are dealing drugs or carrying a firearm or about to shoot somebody or breaking into a house or a business. There is a pattern that those folks follow. And the courts have recognized that it's in jurisprudence going back sometimes hundreds of years. And that is every single case that is analyzed under that jurisprudence. We have a threshold, just to use an example in the state, of what it takes to exit an individual out of a motor vehicle, meaning ask them to get out of that car. I will tell you that a majority, vast, into the 40s of numbers of states in the United States, do not follow this. The Supreme Court of the United States does not follow our jurisprudence in terms of exit orders. So when an officer pulls over a vehicle for a broken taillight, in most other jurisdictions in the country, they're able to say, get out of the car without anything further. And that's the Supreme Court of the United States has determined that to be a reasonable safety precaution for those officers in all of those other jurisdictions. Ours has not. Ours has, because of the fear of profiling, which is not based upon reasonable and articulable facts. Because of the fear of that and the misapplication of using a pretextual traffic stop to get somebody out of a car, because of potentially the color of their skin, because that's, I think, what we're talking about in terms of profiling. Our officers have to approach that car and need to have something more that will make them fear for their safety. They have to be able to articulate that, and they do every day on the stand. And it's up to a judge to determine whether or not they had enough. And what I will tell you is this. I don't want to be at that car at 2 a.m. I don't want to be approaching that car at 2 a.m. And I have to credit these gentlemen. They are, and women in law enforcement. I've been blessed to work with some of the best in Boston as well as here. They have cool heads, and they frankly have a cooler head than I probably would, approaching that car filled with five guys who we know are gang members, who may have shot somebody earlier, who may have been involved in something where they're desperate to get out of there. You're evaluating that situation in order to achieve that higher standard. So I take issue with profiling, because it is something far, far greater than that, in terms of those patterns that you're talking about that amount to what is called, on the legal terms, reasonable and articulable suspicion.
One other question, Marie, may I ask another question? Throughout law enforcement, and in particular the law enforcement among the partnership that's coming into Brockton, where the citizenry of Brockton is very diverse, and it's quickly becoming, if not already becoming, a diverse community, a majority minority. It's just a sort of false statement, but it's a common statement that people use. Does the law enforcement personnel reflect, or is there an effort among those who have big green light of hiring to make certain that the officers that are patrolling and keeping the streets safe reflect the diversity of the city that they have protected? What is the trend? What is the feeling? Is law enforcement so neutral that it doesn't matter who's patrolling the streets? I'm trying to get your opinions and just get an overall feeling of how our law enforcement officers and the people that are protecting us feel about the people that they're protecting.
In a perfect world, it should be neutral and it should not matter. But we don't live in a perfect world. But I will say this, that Brockton has taken strides to hire minorities within the police department. I'm not involved in the hiring process, and I don't track that myself, sir, to be honest with you. But I know that over the last several years, 4 or 5 years, maybe even go back further, that they have done a great job of increasing to the point where I think we're one of the highest in the state, ratio-wise.
To be respectful of people's time, and I really appreciate that it's like about 90 degrees out still, and it was a great turnout. So we want to try to adhere to the time frame, so that way we can definitely have that. So just be thoughtful of your questions, and get a chance to ask hopefully the next party.
Well, one of our commitments is to be respectful of folks' time and to start and end on time. Mean to say that we won't hang around afterward. In fact, I think the best parts of the meetings are the after part. So please, and I don't want to rush you, by the way.
Hi, my name is Leona Martin. And I think I heard the chief say that there were patrols in all the areas of Brockton, and that you focus more on the troubled areas. My neighborhood is pretty safe. But I don't think I've ever seen a police car in my neighborhood. And I don't know, you could consider that a good thing because neighborhood is safe, but it would be nice to see people, see your officers.
I don't know how to respond to that, unless you're sitting in your window 24 hours a day watching your street.
No, not doing that.
There's a possibility that police officers may be up and down that street. You don't see them. I don't know where you live, but
I'm on Brea Circle.
Brea Circle?
Yeah.
Well, I can tell you, I use Brea Circle as a cutthroat, and I'm driving my cruiser constantly. Only my cruiser is not something you're going to notice.
Okay.
So I mean, I can tell you right now that there have been cruisers on your street constantly, because I live down the end of Ash Street. So, okay.
Can I also just say that's not the chief, that's Lieutenant LeBrace. Although, sure, it's the next.
No, I think she was referring to Chief.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
Sure, just one more question.
A small question. I just wondered, do you have a resource list that you could give out to us that we could share to our friends, family members, and so on, of ways in which we can contact any of these agencies? Because I would just like to have that handy at home.
I don't have it now. I would go in the City of Brockton, City of Brockton Police Department.com, and you'll be able to get everything you need right there. All of the phone numbers are listed, all of the agencies we work with.
And on our website as well, we have many, many phone numbers for folks to reference on the website of the Plymouth DA's office. And we're also likely have some flyers printed up, so once we do that, we'll distribute them as well. Okay. Thank you. Does anybody else have anything else? Tracy, did you have something?
Joe, you're getting good. You don't play me.
Thank you, Joe. I worked with Joe many years ago. I just have a question regarding funding. I remember years ago, back in 2001, 2002, being a member of Weed and Seed and the Safe Neighborhood Initiative, that they had a grant writer in the DA's office that would write grants for funding. And if so, I think in terms of prevention, that money could be used towards the school department, middle schoolers, or even the elementary school, where we could have prevention in terms of anti-gang, anti-drug usage. So the money is available. I'm wondering if that is possible.
Yeah, all those programs that you referred to from back 15 years ago, you know, Weed and Seed, Safe Neighborhood Initiative, we have Project Safe Childhood, we have Project Safe Neighborhood, all of those funding sources are gone. They no longer exist, and I'm hopeful that at some point they're gonna rise again. We actually, just recently this year, we've applied for the latest Project Safe Neighborhood grant, which we were, when I say we, I mean the Plymouth DA's office, was recognized as the only DA's office in Massachusetts that's available for it, which is the good news. The bad news is there's only gonna be 5 of them countrywide. So we've been working hard to try to get A, recognized to be the right area to get it. And thanks to a lot of good work by people here putting numbers together, we were recognized as that. But now it's gonna be the question of the appropriation of the money. And that money goes back, like Weed and Seed, like some of the other ones, back into the community, trying to, you know, like Weed and Seed's, the theme of that was to, you know, weed out crime and seed in business. And Project Safe Neighborhood was focusing on a lot of the gun violence that was happening in certain sections of urban communities of a certain size, and most of those sizes of the community, 75,000 or plus, which in our county, only Brockton fits that population scale. So although there is nothing per se right now, we continue to work with the grant issues as pertains to a lot of the drug issues. We're dealing with a lot of the drug-free community things that we get in turn. That money goes back, I wouldn't say money runs through our office, but it goes to the local communities. The Brockton Opiate Coalition, which consists of 5 towns in our county, including Brockton, Whitman, Rockland, there's 2 more, which I can't recall off the top of my head, that are involved in that coalition, and getting other monies. And a lot of that stuff is, once again, we're trying to get, and we want to be involved with the schools. I mean, and that's the thing, is that, you know, we used to do Operation Ceasefire under one of the PSN grants many years back. And I'd like to see that again. I'm very hopeful that we're going to get that grant. I'm also very hopeful that there'll be more state grants also that we can apply for to put back into the community and try to help what I think, you know, you got to help kids when it's worthwhile helping them, when they're younger, not when they're 14, 15, 16. Get them at a younger age, and I'm hopeful we can do that. Yes, Glenn.
There's some long trials that you've had. It's fantastic. I mean, there's a program that you had that really was good, and the kids really learned a lot from it. I do believe prevention starts in the schools. You know, I mean, it's great that we can teach the adults, but the junior highs, there are no programs in junior highs.
Yeah.
So we're hoping to work on a program that may be related to drugs, teaching children in the junior high choices. And
I think you're right. I think one of the other issues that we continue to see are really the drug endangered children. And when you're talking about people who may be addicted to opiates and they have children, they're no longer able to take care of their kids. So their parents, the grandparents, once again, are becoming parents by themselves, trying to take care of their grandkids. It's not unusual to see an old man like me with a young kid. And what it is, it's they're taking care of their grandkid. They're taking them to Little League. They're taking them where it's so, you know, how do you help? And how do you get in front of a lot of those issues? And you have to work from, really, once again, it is a community issue. It's not going to just be a law enforcement issue. It's going to be a much bigger piece of the puzzle. I think we're definitely a piece of it, and I think we're going to continue to be involved in it and try to get the resources that we can have to make sure that we're going to be in a position to help as many people as we can, because, you know, on a selfish end of it, the more people we help at a younger age, we're not going to be seeing them later. You know, so, and that's a good thing. You know, keeping kids busy, I mean, that's a great thing in the summer. You know, to, you know, idle hands when kids are going out and being kids and doing sometimes foolish things. Let's keep the kids busy and let's make sure we can get them, I think, education at a younger age, especially with the terrible drug stuff that's going on.
The Citizens Committee, who is the Citizens, what's it, the Academy, Citizens Academy?
Citizens Police Academy?
Get that back, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, right. Officer Lee
from the city of Brockton wants to be on that, and so that they know how to handle it.
Yeah.
And it's a fantastic program.
And some towns in our county still do that. I think it's that's a resource thing. I'm not sure what it is. I know that there's at least three or four off the top of my head I can think of that continue to do Citizens Police Academies, and they get a chance to go visit the jail and the sheriff's department, and they get a chance to come and listen to, sometimes they'll bring prosecutors in, and they'll talk about a lot of the issues that are going on, maybe a lot of the same stuff that we're talking about. Because, you know, a lot of people aren't involved in the system. They don't know, you know, other than what they see on TV. And, you know, like I tell everybody, you know, if you're watching Law and Order, or if you're watching CSI, you know, Crime and Conviction in 60 minutes with commercials, that's not what we do. You know, but unfortunately, many people sometimes think it is.
You know, and Tracy, you've seen this, I'm sure, in many, many, many years of what you do. You know, we see kids who turn into adults who are exposed to trauma at a very early age. And that trauma does a lot of strange things when it goes untreated. When you witness violence, whether you're a victim of violence or you witness it, you know, mental health-wise, it does a lot of things. And you know, what I want to just say is we've had 9 months of relatively little of that violence that our kids would be otherwise exposed to. That's huge. If you can extend that for a little while longer, imagine you've got a kid who's 9 months old, or 5 years old, or 10 years old, who hasn't been exposed to that kind of violence for a year or a year and a half. That's a very formative time in that kid's life, and that all of a sudden becomes, you know, something that fills itself just by simple subtraction. So that's an amazing thing, and I just have to say it's a really amazing time. So.
And one of the program you talk about, kids that are traumatized because they watch violent things occur in their home, you know, we're precluded many times about talking about things with the schools. You know, if Johnny sees his dad get arrested one night, you can't call the school up the next day and say, hey, you know, watch Johnny, because his dad was arrested right in front of him last night. He might be acting out, he might be doing something he doesn't normally do. So, you know, we've had programs in the past, once again, with Officer Liebberg, and we're trying to establish a new one. Actually, we're trying to establish it countywide on a much more simplistic basis. And actually, we started one here in Brockton, and myself and some of my office actually went down to West Virginia a few years back, talked about it. They've taken it and really tweeted it down so that they call their program Handle With Care. And so they don't, what they'll do is, if there's a traumatic event that occurs in their community and some kids are at their home and a parent or a brother or somebody gets arrested, something terrible happens in front of their home, they're precluded to talk about, the police are, about what actually happened. But what they can do, and what they do is they call the schools and say, hey, you know, Johnny Smith, handle him with care tomorrow. And that's all they need to know. Something happened. And maybe a kid who's maybe the most quiet kid in the room all of a sudden is throwing something or hitting something or jumping out at somebody. And now they know there's a reason for that. You know, we're dealing with lots of the issues that we can. There's only so many things we can actually talk about. You know, there's many things that we're precluded about from various statutes, privacy, health reasons, HIPAA, all those different things that are out there. And I think that if there's a way that you can try to get in front of that, maybe that's something that can work. I know I talked to the Abington police chief about 2 weeks ago. I know they're doing that in Abington now, and I'm hopeful that, you know, we can get that up and running once again here in the city and deal with the issues, you know, and try to be in front, try to be proactive versus reactive. And, you know, like when you're up against it, you're reactive. And when, you know, a year or two back when we were really, I hate to say the phrase, under the gun, that's what it felt like. There was something happening. We would have one of these meetings and something's going on outside. And we need to be in front of that. And I think that, you know, once again, with all your help and all your support, we're going to be in a position where we continue to do that and try to stay where we are, knock on wood. Because like I said, you know, even a watch pot's going to boil every now and then. And when you're dealing with the police officers, who I think are doing a great job trying to stay on top of the issues with their limited resources in conjunction with everything else, I think it's been a remarkable job over the last year or so in trying to stem the violence that's been here in the city.
They say we have great teachers, too, that are ready for that.
Good.
So,
great.
The
closest
thing to their family.
Thank you.
So, as we said, we want to be respectful of everybody's time, and we really appreciate everyone coming out. Before we close, though, again, another word of thanks to Bob Miller, and I know Bob wanted to say a few words before we concluded, and maybe, Bob, you could take us out.
Thank you for coming, by the way, and everyone else as well. I see a lot of familiar faces. For those who don't know me, my name's Bob Miller. I've been in the city for about 40 years, and I've seen it change for the worse. I just want to see it get better. I wasn't going to say anything tonight, but I'm just going to, I just want, when I read this, I just want you to understand that I am by no means lecturing anybody. I wrote this to the public to try to get people here. So I just wanted you to hear it, and maybe you can spread the word, so next meeting, you'll have a bigger turnout. As we all know, we all have a beautiful thing in our lives that's called choice. We can choose what to do or what not to do, what to say or what not to say, where to go or where not to go. That being said, the men and women that have chosen to put their own lives at risk to protect and serve our community in order to keep us all safe and from harm's way have also chosen to meet with the public on a regular basis to hear your concerns, if any, and to stay updated on where the attention needs to be focused on. It is impossible to know all when they can't be everywhere at all times. It's impossible to know the areas they don't know if no one speaks out. Sorry about this. I'm blind too. These men and women are offering to listen, to assist where needed, and in my opinion, are going out of the way to do so. Please, if you are concerned, make an appearance and let them hear what your concerns are. Just remember, our city, even though it has improved a little in the past few years, it's still far worse than I remember 40 years ago, 35 years ago. And could be much better, but no one can accomplish this alone. Over the past decade, where things have worsened, there have been many people that chose to go where they wanted to go, but never had the choice to come home. And I know this occurs everywhere, but it should not occur as often as it does in Brockton. Our citizens, our people, and our children should have the choice to go anywhere without being in fear. Much love to all. Peace.
I just want to thank you all.
If I just may say thank you to that, and thank you for others who have shared on your social media. Unfortunately, I don't, but I know office does try to use social media like Twitter, and the Enterprise has published this. I constantly probably email many of you in this room, and thank you for those who I just emailed this afternoon as a reminder and did show up, or your supervisor sent a rep or something like that. I want to recognize probation department is here, from Superior. Tracy, thank you so much, as well as two other assistant chief and chief probation officer in charge. Correct, is that right? Thank you so much for them to be here. And I just want to say, when I send the emails, if you don't mind sharing it, posting it at your agency, at your church, at any place that you think you'll be visible, so that way others can come and join us. And we thank you so much for coming again.